So welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Good. To the Beacon Campaign Association 2017 Federal By-Election Candidates Debate. I just want to go over the instructions one more time before we get started with the questions. So candidates will have a 2-minute introductory speech and a 1-minute closing statement. For each question, candidates will have 90 seconds to respond. Once each candidate has responded, we'll allow a 30-second rebuttal to each candidate if they would like it. Mr. Tim Tierney has generously agreed to be timekeeper this evening. When there's 10 seconds remaining, he'll raise the yellow flag. When you are out of time, you'll raise the red flag. Please be courteous and end your speech once the red paper is raised. The questions asked this evening have been selected from those submitted by the public on the Beacon Hill Community Association website. The questions will be read in the language that they were submitted. As per the rules agreed to, we will not be taking questions from the floor. Finally, we would ask that no signs or banners be placed inside the gymnasium. Campaigns may hand out literature inside the school, with the exception of the gym. We ask that no candidates campaign outside school grounds. So the order was determined by draw prior to the meeting, and we'll begin with Mr. Turmel, then proceed to the person to the left, which in this case would be all the way around to the far end, continuing until all candidates have responded. Each subsequent round, we will start off with a different candidate, the person on the left of the candidate who led off the previous round. So we'll begin with the introductory speeches. Each candidate will have 2 minutes, and we'll start with Mr. Turmel.
Well, those of you who remember John the Engineer Turmel ran for mayor in the 80s and 90s, talking about money before. I'm back, election number 91, Guinness record. And again, I'm gonna point out, this is a graph of Canada's national debt. And you'll notice it started to grow in 1974. Now these little blotches down here, that's what we paid in interest over the last 40 years. But there's a national debt. Well, guess what? In France, same thing. The national debt started to grow. When? 1974. What happened? Ontario, provincial debt. Started to grow. What year? 1974. What happened? Quebec. Quebec provincial debt. Started to grow. What year? 1974. What happened? Now you gotta understand the national debt over the last 40 some years, we've paid out over $1 trillion in debt service. Divide that by 35 million Canadians, that's like 30, 40 G's apiece. When you count up what the provinces and the municipalities and the corporations charge us and our personal interest, we probably paid 70 grand worth of debt service since 1974. Now, what happened that took 70 grand out of each and every one of your bank accounts? That if this hadn't happened in 1974, all that interest, those 2 trillions in interest that we suffered in taxation over the last 40 years, what happened in 1974 to cause that? Well, I got some videos on my site, which I'm the first person to take out. Smartestmanonearth.ca. No one else dared.
Thank you.
Out. I'm not telling you.
Bonsoir, good evening. Ottawa Vanier, c'est chez nous. It is where I was born, where I studied, where I started my business, and it's where I've chosen to raise my family. I am Mona Fortier, a mother, a local businesswoman, a University of Ottawa graduate, a community leader, and a progressive liberal. Ottawa Vanier est une circonscription remplie d'entreprises locales, une circonscription qui abrite certaines des institutions publiques les plus importantes du pays et un endroit que je suis fière d'appeler chez moi. Ottawa Vanier's inclusive neighborhoods like Beacon Hill are reflective of our collective understanding that we are stronger together, that our social and cultural fabric is to be celebrated, not used to divide us. I am proud that I was born at Montfort Hospital and have had the pleasure of serving on its board of directors. I'm also grateful to have worked with community leaders to strengthen local institutions and proud to have helped make the Shaw Center into a world-class facility. I am a builder and a collaborator and have worked with school boards, our hospital, nonprofit organization, and the business community. I've also worked with stakeholders from all levels of government because I believe that together we can continue to make Ottawa Vanier stronger. We must work harder and faster, but we must do so in a measured and evidence-based manner. Justin Trudeau sait qu'un Canada fort commence avec une classe moyenne forte et avec votre aide et votre soutien, j'ai hâte de travailler avec lui pour bâtir un avenir meilleur pour nous tous. I am running to be your next member of Parliament because I believe that I have the skills, the experience, and leadership to help communities prosper in the 21st economy century. Thank you very much, and I look forward to taking questions.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for taking the time to be here tonight. My name is Adrian Papar and I'm your conservative candidate for the Ottawa Vanier by-election. I'm a proud Canadian who came here as an immigrant at the age of 13. And I've earned a bachelor's degree in economics from South Fraser University and worked for years in financial services and marketing. And in 2013, I decided to come to Ottawa to earn a master's in business at the University of Ottawa. And during this time, I lived in Gloucester, not too far from here, and gain appreciation for our community in Ottawa Vanier. I worked for two members of Parliament the past few years, and I have a good understanding of what it takes to be an effective MP and a strong voice for taxpayers. Over the past few weeks, I've met hundreds of Ottawa Vanier residents, and they all share a common vision for the surrounding, which is to make it a place for people to live, work, invest, and visit. So my priorities for Ottawa Vanier is to focus on job creation and home ownership, employability for those economically and socially marginalized, keeping our streets safe, and supporting accessible projects that make our community more livable. I care about our community, and that's why in the last week's debate, I publicly made a commitment that if I'm elected as MP, I will donate 10% of my gross wages to organizations that work to help those who are vulnerable in Ottawa Vanier. I am the only candidate that can hold the Liberal government accountable for its out-of-control spending, higher taxes, and broken promises. That's because as an opposition MP, I have more freedom to speak my mind than a Liberal backbencher. On April 3rd, I want you to make your vote count. I will be a tireless voice for taxpayers in Ottawa Vanier and to make sure that Justin Trudeau doesn't continue to nickel and dime you in every aspect of your life. Thank you for being here.
That's where I can come in. Because I can hold the government accountable.
As a former federal prosecutor and community activist, I know how to get to the heart of a problem, build consensus, and broker real solutions. I'm committed to working with all levels of government and across party lines to make sure the needs of our communities are being met. Je suis prête à me joindre à l'opposition pour que le gouvernement demeure fidèle à leurs promesses. If you elect me, I will hold the government to the commitments they've made to us and truly represent the needs of all of our communities. Thank you.
Kids have a way of claiming your attention at inopportune times, and you can't say no to kids, so. But here I am, and I'm happy to be here, even though I'm about to fall off this chair. Good evening, everyone. Bonjour à tous, friends, supporters, fellow and sister candidates. It's really good to be here. I like being in schools. I work in schools. Greens, I joined the Green Party, and I'm running for the Green Party because I believe that the Green Party has actually the most sustainable, most comprehensive, most long-term plan for our future as Canadians. I'm joining with the Greens to be joining with caring, committed Canadians from all walks of life to speak up and to act together for the Canada that we want. A Canada that understands that economic prosperity and environmental sustainability go hand in hand. They're not at cross purposes in the present 21st century economy. A Canada that respects the processes and institutions of democracy, accountability, and transparency. And we all know what's happened with the Electoral Reform Commission recommendations, and it's very, very discouraging. A Canada that works for social justice so that every Canadian will have the security of the basic necessities of life, guaranteed by a Green proposal for a guaranteed livable income, which is a part of our core platform, not a crisis management policy thrown in when we see people homeless and without, but a core part of our platform. A Canada that supports small business. Small business, which creates 70% of the jobs in our country. By the way, I learned recently that 6 to 8% of the Alberta economy is from the tar sands and other resource industries. 6 to 8 versus 70% of jobs being created by small business. And a Canada that reclaims its role on the international stage as a peacemaker and peacekeeper. Thank you.
We will now proceed to the question phase of the debate. The first question will be to Mona Forte, and then we'll proceed to the right in the same order. Candidates will have 90 seconds to respond, after which there will be a 30-second rebuttal. The first question is, what will you do to create jobs in this community?
Well, I think that's a question that I've been asking different employers and entrepreneurs for the past 5 months. I've been involved in meeting and saying the same thing as the entrepreneurs have been saying. We need to bring more jobs in Ottawa Vanier, and I'm committed to work with them and see how we can find subsidies or opportunities to invest in creating jobs in Ottawa Vanier. I think that together with the employers and with the assets that we have here in Ottawa Vanier, with the National Research Council, with La Cité, Montfort Hospital, and other employers, we can find ways to bring new jobs here in Ottawa and make sure that we strengthen our middle class and bring also investments to our communities.
Thank you for your question. I've made this very clear throughout the campaign that my intention is to work with the University of Ottawa and Cité Collégiale to be able to work with students in entrepreneurship courses. And there's a lot of great ideas that come out of business schools. And I've seen two businesses get created out of entrepreneurship courses at the University. And we need to be able to support our universities to nurture these ideas and turn them into local businesses. I'm also displeased with the fact that our Liberal government has still not followed up on its commitment to lower small business tax rate.
Struggling to find employment. And I was very discouraged when I heard the finance minister stand up and say that Canadians should start getting used to a future of short-term, temporary, precarious employment. That is not the kind of political leadership that we need. We need a policy framework to encourage not only the creation of new jobs, but the creation of good jobs, stable jobs with benefits. Are you sure about that time? I echo Mr. Papera's comments regarding the commitment that was made in the last campaign to lower the small business tax rate, a commitment that was abandoned days after the election campaign, if I recall correctly, certainly very, very early on in the Liberal mandate. This is the kind of wiggle room that would give small businesses a greater opportunity to hire employees. I would also like to see the government consider implementing tax measures that would incentivize companies to create full-time jobs where they can. Because I'm very concerned, in particular for our young people, who are very worried about their future, their prospects of being able to afford appropriate housing, manage their student debt, which is growing at an alarming rate, while at the same time having concern about moving from contract to contract and not having stable employment. So certainly something this is the NDP is very engaged in working on, and I look forward to doing so. Thank you.
Reduce small business taxes to 9% immediately and restore corporate tax rates to 19% over a fixed period. That would support small business, which again is 70%, create 70% of the jobs in this country. Greens would also create jobs by reintroducing and expanding the home renovation tax credit to create incentives for individuals and companies to make their homes and businesses more efficient and accessible by installing high-efficiency insulation, etc. The Green Party supports the creation of a Canadian infrastructure bank that will provide innovative financing for small business and partnership. Those infrastructure projects create jobs. And we believe, finally, that investing in green technology goes hand-in-hand with boosting our economy and creating local jobs into the 21st century. So we support federal funding, substantial federal funding for green technology innovation. Thank you.
So, what have I done to create employment around the world that got me invited to address the Millennium Assembly in 2000 at the United Nations? In 1974, I financed the production, 84, the production of this LETS, local employment trading software, time banking. It allows single poor parents to log on what nights they can double duty babysit each other's kids and pay each other with 1 hour bills, even when they're broke. Next thing you know, the mechanic's taking 3 hours per hour, the dentist is taking 6 hours per hour, and a resource network grows around these poor people based on babysitting hours. That's called time banking, and I finance the world's software. And every time a country crashes, Greece, Portugal, Russia, you always start hearing about this famous LETS software from Canada that started time banking way back when. So, that's what I've done all around the world to create employment without any money, by having people create their own poker chips based on time that allows them to local employment trading software, software for trading employment locally. Now, I know you're looking for the government to do it for you. No one ever expects you to do it yourselves, right? Well, in 96, when I ran against Sheila Cox, and I said, I don't need to get elected, I just need someone with brain to pick up the software and do it yourself. 1 month later, they picked it up and they started the LETS.
Thank you.
We'll now begin the 30-second rebuttal round, where you'll have an opportunity to add to your answer or rebut something else you've heard at the table. So each candidate will have an additional 30 seconds, and we're going to start with Mona Fuji. Mr. Papara.
I just wanted to add one point because I got a little flustered there. That the government, the current government's been talking a lot about investments in innovation, and I think it is really important that we support innovation in this country. But I'd really like to see a policy framework coming around innovation so that we're not just talking about financial investments, but also making sure that the policies that are in place to protect, for example, intellectual property rights, so that companies can actually afford to stay in Canada, upscale, and create jobs here at home. Thank you.
One of the biggest deficits in employment right now is that people lack the skills as our economy is shifting so quickly, and we need to invest very aggressively in education, training, apprenticeship to make sure that older workers and young people can keep up with this ever-changing digital post-information age. Economy that we're moving into, that we are in. So education, training, and apprenticeship consistently, and we have to invest in people.
And here's how it's going to work. Like PayPal. You know PayPal? Duh. You log on to the Bank of Canada's computer, you open an account. Instead of pledging a credit card in cash, you pledge 1,000 hours of labor, helping out the government somewhere, and that's your basis of your credit line. So, you get a Bank of Canada account, interest-free, and you cut checks to pay off all your interest-bearing debts, and after that, all your payments go against principal. And that's what you can do if you get a Bank of Canada
Thank
account.
Thank you, Mr. Turmel. We'll now go to the next question. We'll be starting this round with Mr. Papara. The question is, what concrete steps would you take to fix? What concrete steps would you take to fix the Phoenix payroll system and ensure all affected workers are properly compensated? Begin with Mr. Papara. You'll have 90 seconds to respond, and then we'll start at 30 second rebuttal.
Thank you for your question. I understand that when the rollout came out with the Phoenix system under our Liberal government, a lot of people have suffered a lot. Some were overpaid, some were not paid. At the last debate, I said that, you know what, I think we should invest more money into training staff at pay centers. But I've given more thought since, and I feel that, you know what, I think we should take this to a study in a committee responsible for Phoenix Bay and see what recommendations they come up with and make sure that these recommendations get implemented as soon as possible. It's unfortunate that, you know, it's getting out of hand. It's now costing more than $50 million to fix this backlog that we're seeing. And what disappoints me is that people who were using payroll deductions to donate to the United Way are now afraid to increase contributions or change contributions. And now we see local charities here in Ottawa Vanier suffering that, you know, they have their funding cut back because of this issue.
Well, I think, like all of you, I'm very disturbed by what's happened with the Phoenix pay system. This is clearly a debacle of an enormous magnitude and something that needs to be addressed with great urgency. Unfortunately, it's going to require significant investments because at this point it's just simply unacceptable that we allow our hardworking public servants to go on without adequate pay. What I've proposed is that we do everything that we can to bring compensation back into the departments until such time as the pay center issue can be resolved, because only within a department do human resources professionals have the capacity to really and immediately address the concerns that are being generated by Phoenix. This is not going to be cheap. We're going to have to go. Many of the compensation advisors are no longer embedded in their departments. Some are. For those who aren't, we're going to have to go and find where they are, second them back into their departments, hire experts from other departments to come back in at the local level so that we can ensure that until the glitches in the software are resolved, people are getting their biweekly paycheck that they're entitled to and are not bearing the enormous burden of anxiety for their families. And I mean, I have students, I teach at the University of Ottawa, I have students who haven't been paid since the summer. They're unable to pay their tuition. This would not be acceptable in the private sector, and we should not accept it here either.
I'm in agreement. You make a huge mistake like this, you need to make sure that that you make amends, and the people who are not getting the pay that they deserve or being overpaid, people need to be compensated in good faith and in a timely way. And moving forward, I mean, it's a lesson, right? As a teacher, I say, learn the lessons. Putting in these new and massive and centralized technologies, we need to make sure that we're training people properly. I know that I see in my own area, my own professional life, that often new technologies and new processes now are introduced, and the budgets and the time for training is not commensurate with the new challenges of the new technology. So the adequate training and tech support for these new ventures needs to be put in place, so we don't have a repeat of the Phoenix pay disaster. Thank you.
Yes, people should get fair pay. Who disagrees? Right, okay. How did Argentinian unions get fair pay? They were being cut off. Government had no money. They couldn't bring their bonds to New York to get bills to pay them and tax them out. So the union said, no layoffs. We're going to take small denomination government bonds as long as we can spend them back on hydro, taxes, medical, and licenses. And that way everybody in the province is going to take them. Well, guess what? We could do the same. Government bonds that pay hydro, medical, license, and taxes are pretty good poker chips. And that way we don't have to pay interest on using those interest-free currencies. And that's how Argentinian unions saved their jobs and got to full employment, because they had enough bonds to pay anybody ready to work. I call it the Argentinian solution. Now, didn't make the news, right? No mainstream media told you how Argentina was broke 1 year, and 5 years later, all their national debts paid off. How'd they do that? Nobody told you, right? Well, I just did. And they did it by using an alternate currency, small denomination government bonds, backed up with hydro, taxes, medical, and licenses. We could do it.
Thank you.
This is a very serious issue, and the Liberal government is committed to dedicate resources and time to make sure to fix the system, the Phoenix system. I believe that measures that are being implemented right now, as emergency pay advances, opening temporary satellite offices, and recruiting more officers to help and compensation advisors, is helping to fix some part of the problem, but there's still much to be done, and I believe that we will make it right and put the energy to make sure that we fix the system. The other thing is, for this riding, while I was canvassing, I did have the opportunity to meet with some of our public service officers that did have some issues with Phoenix, and I immediately sent their case to the constituency office, who is still working and finding solutions, the case-by-case solution. So I'm committed to make sure that if any one of you here this evening, or if you know of anyone, that this is something that is very serious, and I would take these information to make sure that we resolve your issues and the rest of the issues accordingly.
Thank you, candidates. So we'll start the 30-second rebuttal round with Ms. Papara. Ms. Tappan? Ms. Dukerin? Would you like to make a rebuttal?
No, thank you.
Mr. Turmel?
Yes. Argentina wasn't alone. Russia had to crash in the 90s, and 750 municipalities and states paid their employees with municipal bond books, bond markets. And 25,000 corporations issued their own Canadian Tire money, or Coca-Cola money, or McDonald's money, and everybody took those rubles because there was nothing else, and it worked fine.
Thank you.
Do it too.
Ms. Fortune? Ms. Fortune, would you like to
see?
Thank you. We'll proceed to the next question. And we will begin this round with Ms. Hatton. The question is, how will you address the medical care and mental health care for seniors in our community?
Well, this is a really important priority in the riding. In the course of my canvassing, I would probably say that the future, the precarious future that a lot of our seniors are facing has been one of the biggest issues that I've been hearing about from residents. I was certainly pleased, one of the few things I was pleased in terms of finance commitments that we heard from, you know, in the recent budget and through the health accords with the provinces, was to see that there will be investments made in home care, which is certainly one step in the right direction. The concern I have, though, is twofold. Number one, we have many seniors in our community who are living alone, and unfortunately are not as well placed as some others to rely on home care because of the lack of support they have when the home care isn't there and available. Secondly, I'm concerned that because the health transfer for general health care funding is so much less than the provinces were anticipating, that there's going to be a lot of pressure on the money that's been earmarked for mental health and home care to go back into the general health revenues. So it's going to be very important that the provinces are able to account for their spending, but I would also suggest that we need to be injecting more and better resources into our healthcare system. Given that we're in a by-election, I can tell you that if I were to be elected in my role in opposition, I would be pushing the government at every turn to move forward with a reasonable senior strategy so that we can address these issues appropriately.
Submission was that, similar to what Emily has said, the federal transfers to the provinces for home care and mental health, while a good step in the right direction, need to be, there has to be accountability on the part of the provinces for where that money goes. It needs to be targeted for home care and mental health services to seniors. We need, the Greens also support a national senior strategy that includes a national pharmacare program. When we buy the pharmaceuticals that seniors need in bulk, we can cut the costs of those substantially. So we support a national senior strategy, including a national pharmacare strategy.
So that's basically how bartering time is being done in Japan where 60% of their people are connected. Think about that, how that must help their healthcare system. So yeah, they support looking for new ones in the horizons that might be there someday. And I'm saying, here's a good one already working. Freya Kipu in Japan. Check it out.
So how do we address medical care and mental health care for our seniors?
I just told you.
I believe that the recent agreement accord with the Ontario government is a good first step because we are investing in mental health care and also home care. We'll have to make sure that the province, we work well with the province and even the city to make sure that Ottawa Vanier get its fair share. We have a very high percentage of seniors here in our part of the riding. I've met with many of them in seniors' home centers, and there are needs. So I want to make sure that I monitor and bring what we need in our part of the riding for mental health care and also home care.
You know, as my parents near retirement age, my dad is 63 years old now. Senior care is something that's top of mind for me, just personally. And, you know, I'm very happy that our Liberal government has made some agreements with the provinces for more healthcare funding. But when I met with the Canadian Nurses Association, I echo Mr. Grant. They were expressing some concern in terms of transparency, where the money is going. And also, they were also talking about performance indicators. How effective is this money going to be? Are we just going to throw money at a problem, or are we actually going to see that it's actually helping seniors? And I think when it comes to mental health, it's a two-part thing. We have to look also at, is there the social infrastructure that the seniors depend on so they can be active, they can be able to engage with others, so, you know, to avoid stress, depression, and isolation. And, you know, the last budget in 2016 promised money for social infrastructure, and we're seeing that it's not trickling through to our community. And, you know, when we met, when I met with the local city council, Mr. Tierney, we discussed the fact that we have a senior center that's he's seeking more money to expand this, so more seniors can enjoy the social activities here in Ottawa Vanier, especially in Beacon Hill.
Now the opportunity for a 30-second rebuttal. Ms. Tan. Mr. Turmel.
I had one, but I forgot. It seemed a moment.
I just also want to add the fact that the Liberal government is committed to work on the national housing strategy, and I think that in there we'll also see some measures and initiatives to make sure seniors have a secure and comfortable retirement and access to affordable housing. So we have to bridge all those, not only the mental health strategy, but also home care together to make sure our seniors have a secure and safe retirement.
I would like to add onto Ms. Fortier's comment about the national housing strategy. The money that was promised in this budget, it's promised $5 million, I believe, 5.5 over 11 years. We have to keep in mind that over 3/4 of this money will only become available after the next election. We need this money for seniors now, not after the next election.
We'll now proceed to the next question, and this question will begin with Ms. Dukeran. The question is, can you please discuss your personal stance, not your respective party line, on the debate around electoral reform?
Well, I'm happy to say that, in fact, my personal stance does align with the Green Party's position on electoral reform, which is that we 100% support electoral reform.
We are one of the last holdouts in the Western world, Western democracies, to use a very antiquated, unjust, unfair, unrepresentative system, which we call first past the post, and we're very irrationally attached to it. But when you look at the facts and when you look at the evidence, you will see, and many of us have seen as we learn about this rather admittedly dry topic, that we don't live in the representative functioning democracy that we think we do. And countries, for example, I learned on the weekend that the recent election in Holland, which some of us were very inspired by, because in fact they didn't give power to the movement to the right sweeping across Europe, but in fact elected a kind of middle liberal centrist party, that 12 different parties are represented in the House in Holland. They have more than 12, but they have 12 different parties represented in New Zealand, in Australia, in Germany, in places with proportional representation. You get a parliament or a House of Commons that looks like the country. You get women, Aboriginal people, marginalized minorities, you get the differently abled, everybody gets to come to the table, and that's a fundamental premise of a functioning democracy, is that everybody's sitting at the table. That's
Thank
not
you.
What's happening now. Thank you.
Imagine if under proportional representation, I got in. Can you imagine how I'd chop up the scores? As an example, all those major political parties believe that these are the warmest years in history because of the hockey stick graph. But if you look to see where it should have been by this year, it broke off, they got a problem. They had to use a trick to hide a decline. It's turned the other direction. And guess what, hottest years? You ever heard of the medieval warm period when Greenland was green? Hey, I'll worry when Greenland's green again. Till then, I say global warming's bullshit. But all the more of these parties believes in it. Look at this. All I gotta do is crunch the numbers and you dunces believe it. Hey, medieval warm period when they had vineyards in Great Britain and Greenland was green. It ain't green now. Don't tell me this is the warmest period ever. Dream on.
National referendum. I did not vote for the last Liberal government, and they shouldn't And I'm very proud that, you know, our Conservative Party has been able to accept people with different opinions under our, you know, big blue tent without having to create more parties in Canada. Thanks so much.
Thank you, sir. I strongly favor a proportional representation system. I believe, as Mira said, that we need to have a system that allows, for example, the people in this room that don't have a tradition of voting Liberal to feel that their views and their values are represented in the House of Commons. I do not, on the other hand, favor a particular model of proportional representation, and I was so looking forward to having that discussion as the government committed to do over 1,800 times, as you know, both during the last campaign and after it. The committee heard from a number of experts and from the public, and there was an overwhelming consensus in favor of moving to a more proportional system, despite the fact that the Prime Minister likes to continue to claim that there was no consensus. Almost 90% of experts favor proportional representation that the committee heard from. And so to deprive us of the opportunity to create a Made in Canada system that could have been based on the many other systems that we know of, and to learn from their experience and to take what has worked and to ensure that we have a system that still reflects our regional differences, but to so cynically abandon that promise, giving a completely bogus excuse, if I can put it that way, of lack of consensus and of a risk of fringe parties emerging, was so disingenuous, calls into question the good faith of the entire exercise, and I think we should all be outraged.
Each candidate will have 30 seconds to rebut.
I teach civics, and I teach my kids when I teach about proportional representation that if you get 39% of the vote, what proportion of the seats should you have in the House of Commons? And without exception, they say, Miss, you should have 39% of the seats. It's obvious to any school child that the system we have is not fair and not representative. And the present government spent $4.1 million across this country for a year to engage Canadians in what we thought was a discussion, a national discussion, in good faith about
that you disagree with your party on.
Well, as an independent, those questions are a little moot. But when I ran in the Ontario election, the kids in the school, they had student questions. And they asked me, won't you get upset if you make a decision and people disagree with you? And I said, new world, with game theory, I'm going to say, hey, we're going to win 1 time out of 10 doing this and 2 times out of 10 doing this. Who wants to stand up and disagree when I pick 2? No one! It's a new world when you have the mathematics of gambling to apply it to a real world situation, like Mr. Spock used to do. What was Mr. Spock's education? Applied science, and he knew the odds. What was my education? Carleton, best engineering school in the world at the time, and he's through high school. way to go. So, same education as Mr. Spock, in a new world, we're going to lay out to you why we did too. And who wants to stand up and say, I'd really rather gamble on one? So, that's what's happening now. There's new science out there that's going to change the world of decision making, and that's what I've mastered.
I've been in Ottawa Vanier pretty much all my life. The reason why I want to be in public office is to represent the people of Ottawa Vanier. And I have experience in community work. I have been involved as a volunteer with minority rights, with francophone groups. I've been with the Caisse Populaire Rideau, making sure that we have a caisse that responds to the needs of our society. And for me, if and when I get elected on April 3rd, I want to represent first and foremost the people of Ottawa Vanier. So if I have to vote against my party to be able to represent the views and be the voice of Ottawa Vanier, I will do so. I can do this. And also, if we can, in after April 3rd, have the opportunity to work together with the constituents, with the community leaders, this is how I work. I work as a collaborative person and with my network and also with the people of Ottawa Vanier, with the diversity that we have in Ottawa Vanier, from Rockcliffe to Vanier to Beacon Hill. We need to represent our views and interests, and I'm ready to do this. Thank you.
As I said at the beginning of my speech, being in an opposition, you have more freedom in the decision that you make. And you know, there was an article that came out in 2013 saying that Conservative MPs are most likely to break government ranks when it comes to voting on bills. And I guarantee you that if Esporchi gets elected, she will not vote against her prime minister when it comes to raising taxes when the budget gets cut. Thank you.
Working hard to start establishing those relationships so that people know that they can come to me and openly share their views with me. I'll also tell you that I think too many elected officials underestimate their constituents' ability to understand the complexities of the issues that the country is faced with. And I'm not someone who is going to bypass the opportunity to try to make the case to you if we're in disagreement in terms of, you know, my view on a particular issue and your view. But at the end of the day, it's your view that's going to matter, because you are the people that I would be elected to represent, and I would take that responsibility very, very seriously. Now, one of the questions, which the other candidates, I don't believe, have answered, was with respect to a policy of the party that you disagree with, and I'm happy to answer that question, because I think it's important to be forthright about these things, and I said it in the last election as well, that I wasn't on the same page with the NDP when it came to its position on abolishing the Senate, in large measure because I didn't feel that it was feasible constitutionally. I think Senate reform is very important, given the fact that our senators are enjoy a security of tenure that comes from the fact that they're not elected officials. And so I think that that is something that needs to be looked at and addressed. But given the constitutional limitations, my view was always that it was not feasible to abolish the Senate. Thank you.
In contrast to the three major political parties in Canada, the Green Party of Canada does not have whipped votes. Any Green MP elected, and Elizabeth May is a shining example of that, has the freedom and is encouraged to vote first and advocate first for the needs of her constituents. And that's what she's done. And when I was out in BC in her riding, Sandwich, Gulf Islands last summer, that's one of the things I heard over and over again, that while we have a strong national leader in Elizabeth May, We also, they attested to the fact that she is a very, very, very committed constituency MP and puts the needs of her constituents first. And that's what the Green Party supports and enshrines in our own constitution. We do not have whipped votes. In answer to this question 2 years ago during the campaign, I became a Green because I do actually believe in pretty well everything in that platform, our 184-page platform. It's very, very inspiring and very doable and very fiscally responsible. But when I was asked, I said community mailboxes. You know, they are against community mailboxes and they put them in where I live and it's worked out fine. I meet my neighbors when I go to get my mail and it's not a big disaster after all. But last August at our Green Party convention, a motion was put forward on our BDS, or a boycott, sanction, and divestment policy in the Middle East. And in fact, I voted against my party leader. It was a very divisive and conflicted issue, and we all had the ability and the freedom to vote with our conscience. Thank you.
Now we'll give each candidate an opportunity to rebut. 30 seconds.
Well, an aside on no fraud ballot. smartestmanonearth.ca/no fraud ballot. Think outside the box for a minute, because there's a lot of vote counting fraud out there by the computers. All you gotta do is get a receipt that can prove how you voted, even a carbon copy. If it was in there, you can take it, go home. Then they post online what the vote was beside the number of your receipt. And like the days when you were in school and you went and checked your grade with all the numbers, you could do that again. You could verify if that's your vote, and they couldn't cheat us no more.
Thank you.
No fraud
ballot. Thank you. Ms. Butcher. Ms. Papara. Ms. Tannen. Ms. Dukrin.
Political parties were not part of the original plan in the BNA Act. They evolved, and under the Harper government, evolved into a very, very, very aggressive partisan, hyper-partisan politicking. We need to put public interest, whether at the local, neighborhood, provincial, national level, we need to put public interest ahead of narrow partisan politicking or party solidarity. And Greens work for that kind of collaboration across party lines. Thank you.
Just before we go on to the next question, I just wanted to take a quick pause to remind everyone again that we'd encourage you, if you have not done so already, sign up for a membership for the Beacon Hill Community Association. Your support allows the Beacon Hill Community Association to continue to put on activities such as debates. We also put on Canada Day picnics in the park and fireworks. We maintain rinks. We have a big Beacon Hill garage sale coming up, and we also participate in cleanup in the Capitol. So anyone who wants to sign up, there's a booth outside. In addition, these events aren't free. If anyone feels that they wish to make a donation, there'll be an opportunity to do so outside as well. So I just want to thank everyone for coming out tonight. And we'll continue on with the next question. So we'll start with Ms. Fortune. La question c'est, que proposez-vous pour aider les immigrants et les réfugiés à mieux s'intégrer dans notre communauté?
Merci beaucoup pour la question. Je suis contente même que vous la posiez parce que j'ai eu l'occasion de rencontrer depuis les dernières semaines des leaders communautaires, des membres de la communauté, des communautés multiculturelles de la région, que ce soit les Afghans, les Syriens, les Congolais, les Tunisiens, et tous m'ont mentionné le fait qu'ils avaient de la difficulté à pouvoir s'intégrer sur le marché du travail. Et qu'ensemble, je crois qu'on peut mettre des mesures pour investir dans des projets et des mesures pour permettre non seulement aux nouveaux Canadiens, mais même aux immigrants qui sont ici depuis 10-15 ans et qui cherchent encore du travail, à pouvoir participer à des programmes, que ce soit à la cité, par exemple, qu'on a ici dans notre circonscription, des programmes soit de langue ou de perfectionnement professionnel, afin de mieux s'intégrer sur le marché du travail. Je crois sincèrement qu'ensemble, et c'est ce que nous avons commencé à discuter, en identifiant des priorités et en travaillant autant avec les partenaires, que ce soit au niveau provincial, au niveau de la ville, ou même les entreprises qui, eux, embauchent les gens, qu'on trouve des solutions pour bien intégrer les, non seulement les réfugiés, mais les immigrants dans le marché du travail. Merci.
Thank you for your question. As we have seen, when it comes to Syrian refugees, the ones that actually get a privately sponsored actually do fare much better than the ones coming by the government. And I think it's important that we are able to create more tax benefits for private sponsorships, so the refugees that we take in the future will have a better support going to their families. And also, just going back to my commitment, that's, you know, I committed to giving away, if elected, 10% of my MP wages. That would go to communities that help refugees integrate into our community. We have cases where organizations only have volunteers to send in once a week to check in on families, and we want to be able to give our volunteers to help refugees integrate into our community. I think language learning is one of the big factors. We need to invest more into that. If people don't know the language, they can't find work. And after 1 year, the government stipend runs out, people just find themselves on the brink of disparity. They don't have the money to put food on the table. And going back to the last debate, I said that the government of Canada forgave some travel loans for refugees that came, I believe, before November 2015, but is now charging people up to $9,000 for just to come
Thank
to
you.
Canada.
Plaisir cette année d'avoir fait partie d'un groupe qui a amené une famille de Syrie au Canada. Ils sont installés à Vanier et je suis très fière de dire qu'ils sont très bien établis. Ça fait à peu près 15 mois qu'ils sont ici et on a encore beaucoup de travail à faire. Et c'est pour cette raison-là que moi je pense que c'est vraiment important que le gouvernement continue avec le programme de sponsorship privé. Malheureusement, ils ont décidé cette année d'en mettre un cap de 1000 réfugiés. Malheureusement, les 1000 étaient déjà toutes prêtes pour arriver au Canada au mois de janvier. Alors, c'est tout. On va pas avoir la chance pour le reste de l'année d'en amener d'autres qui vont être tellement bien entourés par une communauté avec toutes les ressources pour les bien appuyer quand ils sont au Canada. Alors, pour moi, une chose, et je dois dire que ce programme-là, c'est en train de devenir un modèle autour du monde, parce que les autres pays ont vu comment, numéro un, les réfugiés sont mieux installés quand ils ont l'appui d'une communauté locale, et numéro deux, que ça enlève, ça fait que le gouvernement ne doit pas trouver toutes les ressources, parce que c'est la communauté qui va trouver les ressources. Alors, on doit continuer vraiment de nous engager à améliorer et agrandir ce programme-là pour le bien de tous les réfugiés qui s'installent dans la ville.
Under our commitment to our international laws on accepting refugees, we should keep accepting genuine refugees into our country. And federally, we need to provide the financial, the funding to support refugees in the integration process. I teach refugees. I teach Syrian kids in my classroom. They started coming into our classrooms last spring, and the needs are very great. I've been teaching immigrants and refugees in Toronto and Ottawa for 28 years, and we've seen, before this influx of Syrian refugees, cuts to budgets so that we have not had enough language training, our class sizes get bigger, liaison officers, multicultural liaison officers, their budgets are cut, so they're not able to be in the classroom working with kids or in schools. So we need to make sure when we're accepting refugees that the federal government is transferring enough money to provinces so that we can meet the needs. Now with the Syrians, as with others like Iraqi kids and their families, we have great needs for mental health counseling. This is a lot of PTSD and other kinds of needs among these populations. So the federal government, 1 year of federal funding
for settlement of refugees is not sufficient, and what we see with the closing of schools all across this province is that our provincial Ministry of Education is not prepared to provide the funds to make up the shortfall. We've seen that most disastrously in this riding with the closing of Rideau High School, that decision a few weeks ago. Thank you.
Refugees, because we help the Americans bomb, we help blow up their countries, and we have to take them in and help. But is there a better way? Can we think outside the box for just a minute? How can we make the refugees want to go back home rather than want to fit in here? How? Now, the same interest-free bank account that Canadian debtors and broke people to get back on their feet at the central bank, having access to credit and the resources you need to rebuild might be incentive enough to go back home and rebuild. You think they really want to come here with the snow and the cold and these angry faces? If they weren't blown out of their countries, they'd probably want to go back. And if they hadn't used depleted uranium, they probably could go back. But let's give them 100 years, and maybe we'll be able to clean up the depleted uranium enough to even go home. But till then, we're stuck with them. We poisoned their land. They can't go back. So, that's it. If we want to help them clean up, they might want to go home. Otherwise, build your walls and get out your guns and get ready to revolution.
Thank you.
What? You want to get out your guns?
Thank you. We'll be in 30 seconds. Ms. Poche?
I think that we need to make more of an inclusive society. We have to find new ways to integrate our refugees and new immigrants, newcomers, and I've been starting to talk about a project just locally with the CESAC and all the other and businesses, so we can collaborate and try to find a way. Because one way that will help newcomers and refugees to integrate the workforce is to have a skills, Canadian experience, and I think we want to try to have a, we're talking about starting a pilot project to see how we could bring the integration and société d'accueil with the businesses to give the opportunity to some of our newcomers here in Ottawa, Vanier, to have an experience, Canadian experience, and then continue to work with these businesses. We have many businesses that could welcome in their own services or in the products that they prepare to make sure that we do integrate the refugees and the immigrants to Ottawa Vanier, because we're an inclusive driving. Thank you.
Just one quick thing I wanted to add is I think a really important component of integration is ensuring that Canadians continue to be as welcoming to newcomers as they have been and maintaining the goodwill that we've seen. And I think what we need to do to ensure that level of goodwill remains as high as it's been is to really think about ways that we can make investments in the settlement communities where a lot of these refugees are going. Because what I'm starting to see is the grumblings of resentment among some, in particular, people who themselves feel marginalized and are struggling to get by, and they feel that resources are being diverted from them to refugees. And while that's not the case, per se, I think if we want to really make sure that those resentments don't get us to a place where we see some countries in Europe going, and certainly in the United States, we need to make sure that we're supporting people in the community, communities of resettlement.
I'd just like to add to that, schools, community centers through which we offer link programs, language instruction for newcomers, job apprenticeship programs, co-op programs, they're all doing really good work helping people.
people, skilled workers and unskilled workers from other countries, integrate into our labor force and do language and cultural language instruction and cultural training in both French and English. What they need is sustained funding. They need commitments from the federal government to be able to continue with and expand those programs. If we're taking in more refugees, we need more money to support all the services to help them integrate healthily and successfully in Canadian society.
We need more money, we need sustained funding, and I know how to reprogram the Mega Canvas computer to do that.
Thank you. We'll proceed to the next question, and we're starting this round with Mr. Papar. The question is, where do you stand on Canada's commitments made as part of the Paris Agreement on climate change? What is your stance on the possibility of Canada buying carbon credits to meet these commitments?
First, I just want to start off, like I said before, I'm very happy that other world governments went forward to Paris with targets that our previous government has put forward. After April 3rd, when we get selected here, this will still be a problem for our Canadian Prime Minister. And, if we're going to talk about climate change and targets and Paris Agreement, we also have to take into account that these targets are not legally binding. If we're gonna strangle our own economy while others freely pollute, that's very concerning to me. I'm also very concerned with the fact that our liberal government took 318 people as part of their delegations to Paris, which cost taxpayers almost $100 million. $1 million. I think management was that they bought carbon credits to offset this. But you know what? Some of them have to fly back to be here in Canada for work, and then they have to fly back. So what does that tell you? Thank you.
Well, where Mr. Papara was proud that we went to Paris with Stephen Harper's targets, there are many of us who were disappointed to see that we didn't go to Paris with a more ambitious target. The Prime Minister himself, when he was in opposition, decried Stephen Harper's targets as woefully inadequate, but then happily went on to Paris and moved forward with those targets. So, not quite sure what to make of that. If you ever listen to any Liberal cabinet ministers or the Prime Minister on any national news program, you will hear them talk about their, the fact that the economy and the environment go hand in hand. It's that exact phrase that they like to repeat. And I don't disagree. I think that is the case. Unfortunately, I think what we've seen since reaching the Paris Accord is a very significant emphasis, preference for the economy over the environment. I don't think that we have a credible plan in place to meet the Paris targets, and I also don't see a plan coming together for our longer term fundamental change in the way we meet our energy needs. The most recent federal budget that came out last week cut $1.25 billion over the next 2 years from the fight against climate change. That doesn't strike me as indicating the level of commitment and seriousness about achieving these targets, and ideally exceeding them, that we need to see. It does not demonstrate the kind of leadership that suggests that this is something that's going to credibly be achieved by the Liberal government.
The Green Party, we'd be in agreement with Emily, and the targets that we went to Paris with are not ambitious enough, they're not aggressive enough. And we need more ambitious targets, and we need them to be legally binding. In terms of carbon taxes, the Green Party does not support the present. We prefer the carbon fee and dividend. That program would tax polluters at source, oil and gas companies, coal, to what extent we have left here, although Trump is reinvigorating the coal industry down south, it seems.
tax carbon via source, tax carbon at source, and then redistribute that income to Canadians as part of our guaranteed livable income. We prefer a revenue-neutral carbon fee, but for sure it's a very foundational part of the Green Party platform to support with tax incentives and tax credits and taxes moving our economy into a post-carbon, clean, green technology economy of the future.
Anybody believe now is hotter than the Middle Ages? How can anybody believe this blip is hotter than the Middle Ages?
Science.
Just because they massaged the data. Guess what? In 09 they got caught. Climate gate. They used a trick to hide the decline. Oh! They used to call it global warming. And if you didn't believe in global warming, they could prove it. Now, suddenly, they changed it to climate change, so that either way, they win. Well, guess what? It still comes out pretty stupid, because who in their right mind is going to try and stop climate from changing? It always changes. It always has, and only a moron will try and stop it. You live with it. So, here's the point, though. In 09, they used a trick to hide the decline. Now, they didn't want to admit it was a decline, makes it look bad because CO2 is still spiking, so they said, we're going to call it a pause in the rise. How many people have heard them talk about the global warming pause, right? There wasn't a pause they hit. They hit a decline. And it's still lower than 1998. And guess what? It's lower than the dirty 30s in 1934. They kept adjusting the data. You're looking at fudged data. Look for the unadjusted data.
Which is very important because our environment is in great danger. And I think that we're taking a responsible and balanced approach way to make sure that our economy and our environment are working hand in hand to make sure that make it right. And I think that we have been moving forward and we are investing in clean energy and we will continue to do this and we will make it right and work with the provincial and with the cities and our businesses to bring to our children better, cleaner energy. Thank you.
Thank you. Now it's 30 seconds. Mr. Popar?
I'd just like to add, President Trump down south just reversed a lot of President Obama's environmental regulations. And even though explicitly he didn't say that he's backing out of the Paris Agreement, that's certainly going to have an effect on the U.S. reaching their goals. And I'm really curious to see what our Prime Minister has to say about this.
Thank you. Ms. Turner?
If we want to be real leaders, we're not going to back down on our environmental commitments because of Donald Trump. And on a related note, I would say that we should also be showing leadership internationally on nuclear disarmament. I was very disappointed to see the government not support a disarmament treaty, which does have a connection to environmental issues and is also using leaders like Donald Trump as an excuse for not proceeding with something that's important to our children's future.
Yeah, Mr. Turmel and Mr. Trump notwithstanding, for the rest of us who understand that we need to do something, and we need to do something ambitious and aggressive, and it has to be the first order of business. It doesn't matter if our economy's working and we're you know, creating 1,000 new jobs if our kids don't have clean water, healthy soil to grow food, clean air, and we see the signs all around us. So, and we also need to look at where the money's going. China invested $84 billion in solar technologies last year. By the time we get pipelines to the West Coast, they won't want our oil. Shell pulled out of the tar sands recently. Follow the...
Well, guess what? I bet you $100 it ain't gonna happen this year. That's how you put those guys down. I offer these global warming bettors, say, hey, I bet you next year's colder, and they all check it out. So forget what they're talking about. Flash the cash, and when they back down, say bye-bye trash. 17's colder than 16, so is 18.
Same with the
Martian.
Thank you. Thank you. Ms. Martin?
I also wanted to add that the Liberal government is investing in green initiatives for grid clean energy development to protect our environment, and we have also initiated a national price on carbon emissions, which will help to work on making sure businesses and enterprises. And we use that money with the provinces to have better infrastructure and implement in our riding and in our province.
We'll now go on to the next question. We'll be starting with Ms. Tannen. The question is, the longer a person is unemployed, the harder it is to find a job. However, access to support programs often depends on EI eligibility, something the long-term unemployed no longer have. Therefore, those in need the help the most receive the least. Do you have any proposals for addressing this problem?
Well, I think the question identifies, is situated in part of a broader problem. And so I made reference earlier to the precarious work crisis and the fact that the Minister of Finance expects Canadians to simply get used to that. I don't accept that proposition. But if one were to accept that proposition, and if this government does in fact accept that proposition, then we would be expecting them to put appropriate social safety net measures in place to address that reality. So it is the case that the overwhelming majority of people who require access to EI benefits do not have access to them, in part because they haven't worked enough hours. And I would agree with the premise of the question that this is a really critical issue to address. And so I think we do require EI reform until such time as the government can put appropriate policies in place to deal not only with the chronic unemployment issue that some people in our community are facing, but also with the precarious work aspect, because that does, in some ways, inflate the numbers of those who are employed, because the precariously employed, when they're between work, often frequently do not have access to EI benefits, and that's something that I think we need to change. And related to that is also pension benefits, because we need to make sure that these people are going to be provided for in their old age. Across the country, we have a lot of different programs to support people in hard times, Canadians in hard times, from EI to various forms of social assistance, disability, welfare, and other kinds of benefits. What the Green Party proposes is to start from scratch with a guaranteed livable income, which would in the end be more efficient, more streamlined, administered with national leadership, so that every single Canadian is provided with the basic necessities of housing, food, health care, and then from there, from that even playing field, can work with various programs, with the aid of various programs, to work on job skills training, social mobility, employment mobility, etc. But instead of the patchwork of programs we have to support Canadians, all of us are at risk of all kinds of things, whether it's health, unemployment, precarious employment. Life is risky, and we need a national strategy in which we provide the basics. That's the Canada, that's what Medicare, that was the vision of Medicare. We need to
broaden that and put it in place on a national level so that no Canadian in between jobs or when hit with poor health or death in the family, etc., has to worry about whether or not they can keep the roof over their head or put food on their table or afford to pay for their own medical bills. Thank you.
Explained how a lax time bank allows employment to be traded around. Local employment trading software generates new employment in the group. It's working around the world for 33 years. So much so that in most countries, if you belong to an official lax time bank, your earnings are not taxed. Unless you're in the business. In the United States, when the IRS wanted to charge people who were, you know, you cut my hair, I'll mow your lawn, or give you cake, or whatever, the provinces, the states argued, look, if this makes people help each other, and they're not going to bug us to do it for them, we don't want to cut their checks. So the IRS made belonging to a time bank trades non-taxable. And it's the same thing in many Commonwealth countries. So, no one expects you to do it yourselves. You can always wait for their strategy, their national strategy, to help you. But, when you get hungry enough, just remember to do it yourself, get organized yourself, local employment training software. That they used to have one in Toronto, they used to have one in Ottawa. They're too small, the economy got better. When it gets bad, you'll know what to do.
Thank you. Ms. Fletcher?
The world economy is changing, and we have to make sure that adults and youth have the proper skills and talent to integrate the job work of the 21st century economy. Last week in the budget, we invested, the Liberal Party invested in innovation and skills, major investments, and the government's innovation and skills plans, I think, will create opportunities for not only lifelong learning, but also to help adults transition and get the skills needed to be able to integrate the workforce, and we have to support these adults and youth to make sure that they are ready to integrate the workforce with the lifelong learning investments that we are proposing.
You know, I hope your concern, and I do agree that, you know, this is in this day of age, young people are in the millennial hustle. You know, they are taking up part-time jobs with no health benefits, no job stability, no pension, and you know, that, I agree with Danny, the fact that people are not going to have enough hours to pay me. I do agree with having to, you know, if we're going to look at reforming the EI for maternity leave, I think one way to do that, we should also look at this. I think that people should be able to collect at least EI if you're going to take an unpaid internship, for example. And you know, this whole budget that came out by the Liberal government, it all focuses on innovation, but it does little to focus on trades. Like, what happened to the trades? You know, those employed people. And let's also take into account that automation will put millions of Canadians out of work in the next few decades. So we need to make that a priority as well. Thank you.
Now we'll do 30-second rebuttals, starting with Ms. Tammy. Ms. Duker.
Our economy is changing very, very, very fundamentally. We have automation, we're going to have driverless cars, we've got all these disruptive technologies, we've got Uber on the streets threatening taxi drivers' livelihood, we've got outsourcing of massive numbers of jobs in the Western world. We have to be smart and forward-thinking about the way we're retraining our people, young and old, to be able to be involved in meaningful work in a 21st century economy. We can't be putting people back
Thank
into
you.
Coal mines like Mr. Trump is trying to do down.
Thank you.
The robots are coming, and they're going to take your jobs because they can do it better. And Major Douglas, the founder of Social Credit, had a great idea. He said, we should get a share of the robots' paycheck, then we won't feel so bad if they take our jobs. Now, he said, how do you do that? He said, well, in the world of the future, instead of giving people a wage for work, they should be getting a dividend for a share in such a rich culture that can have robots produce shoes and you get your share.
Thank you.
Tax the robot paycheck.
Thank you.
It's an interesting one.
Ms. Fortune? So thanks everyone. The next question we'll start with is Duperin. The question is, what is your position on Bill C-27, the bill to amend pension benefits?
I've just been made, I'm not that far away from retirement myself. So this was of great interest to me, and I was made aware of it a few days ago at the Action Sandy Hill debate. It's clear with all of the other sort of macro trends in our economies, one of the trends, and we see it in our own teaching profession, is a pretty organized onslaught against organized labor, undermining a lot of our benefits, pensions and otherwise. And so we oppose Bill C-27. The federal government's move to infringe on the pension benefits rights of federal employees is being watched by provincial governments, and if it passes, will set a precedent for provincial governments to do the same. And as a teacher, we saw this and are seeing this happen in the teaching profession. The playbook was set in how the Ministry of Education would deal with teachers in a very high-handed, unilateral way in BC, and then the present Liberal government did the same thing here. And the onslaught against organized labor and the rights of workers needs to be stopped. And for sure, Bill C-27 is an important part of that resistance. Thank you.
Well, I can only describe the difference between a debtor government and a government not in debt. A sovereign government versus, you know, a debtor government. Well, right now we got debtor governments. And therefore, they're always trying to do everything on the cheap. Including, for instance, our nuclear reactors. They were all built by the lowest bidders, right? Same with Fukushima, lowest bidder. And right now, Fukushima's poisoning our planet, and here we are, humanity's leadership organized to fight climate from changing. And we're not helping Japan clean up. So, it's a new world when you fix money, and you don't have to have governments that are going to fight you to steal every little dollar they can out of you. So when your government's a debtor to some private enter people, they do a lousy job. And when you had kings who printed their own chips, like King Henry I, they weren't debtors. Well, they had nice, happy kingdoms. Go read about it. King Henry I's tallies, same as the Argentinian bond books. It's been done before. So anyway, fix the money and that problem won't occur. The pension funds, they'll just run them themselves and the government won't have to touch them. And they won't want to. Because King Henry had enough money, didn't need to steal people's money. He could print up new tallies anytime he wanted to put people to work. Just like Argentina printed up bonds to put people to work. We could too.
Thank you. Ms. Fortune?
Thank you. Helping Canadians achieve a safe, secure, and dignified retirement is very important, and I believe the Liberal plan is also committed to this. I believe also that the targeted benefit plans represent a voluntary, sustainable, and flexible pension option, which means that if you do want to opt out of it, you can. If you want to keep it, you can also. And I believe that after this first reading, there has been a lot of discussion, maybe some misinformation, and this is why I really want to hear your voice and understand. I'm looking to hear, forward to hearing you, your opinion on this bill and making sure that I represent your views so that the ones that already have a pension plan and don't want to have access to this targeted pension will voluntarily be able to not opt in to this possible new targeted plan, benefit plan. So this is my position, and I'm hoping to hear you after this election.
You didn't answer the question.
Well, I did.
Thank you. Mr. Papara?
Yes, I think we can add this to the list of Justin Trudeau's broken promises. You know, people work hard for their money, and public servants work very hard to build up the tenure to be able to afford a comfortable retirement. And, you know, this is a bill that was introduced by the Liberal government, and our Prime Minister has to ask for this. As conservatives, we believe that when it comes to saving for retirement, we want to give you more options to do that. And so you're able to invest safely for retirement however you think is best for you, and lowering taxes to keep more money in your pockets. You know, the government now is trying to increase CPP contributions in 2018 because they think they know better than you how you should save for retirement. And you know what? We gave a mechanism for Canadians and seniors to be able to save for their retirement with TFSA, the tax for savings account, which the Liberal government froze contributions. I'll just leave it at that. Thank you.
Well, I think it's clear that we are bordering on a pension crisis in our country. More and more Canadians don't have a proper pension. This Bill C-27, an attempt to undermine pensions at a time when we should in fact be trying to strengthen the pension programs that we have, is frankly quite shocking coming from a Prime Minister who promised in writing that he would not touch people's pensions. He would not touch defined benefit pensions that were already in place. Could we blame the government for considering moving forward for new workers, a different approach to pensions? I mean, I would like to see leadership for strong, secure pensions, but to go to people who not only are relying on the defined benefit pension that they collectively bargained for, giving up other things at the bargaining table in exchange for the guarantee of the defined benefit pension, is the exact opposite of the kind of leadership that our government should be showing when it comes to pensions. The claim that workers and retirees will have the opportunity to consent or not consent to having their defined benefit pension plans converted into targeted benefit plans completely misses the point. Number one, why would anybody voluntarily want to give that consent? Why would you want to give up the security of a defined benefit pension and exchange it for taking on the risk that your employer previously undertook to take? It is clear. Have a difficult time making this decision, and who will make the decision on behalf of retirees?
Ms. Newgren, 30 seconds.
According to the Professional Institute of the Public Service, the recent experience in New Brunswick with New Brunswick public employees shows clearly that significant pension reductions are the result of converting from defined to target benefit plans. 3.3 million people under the umbrella of the Canadian Labour Congress are fighting this move from defined to targeted pension benefits. There's something definitely wrong with it, and we're being sold a bill of goods if we think this consent clause is going to allow us to have middle class working people to have secure retirements.
Thank you.
Well, I know I'm talking to posterity in the cameras when I say they won't need pensions. When everybody has their own interest-free bank account with the Bank of Canada, because what is a pension but a savings device where you get a few tax breaks if you save something? So it's just a little bit of saving on your paychecks, right? It's not a pension is. But if you had an interest-free account at the Bank of Canada with access to what you need and no drain of interest every month, you'd have plenty left over. You wouldn't even need a pension.
Thank you. Ms. Fortune?
Yes, I think that I wanted to add the fact that when we got elected in October 2015, we did restore the age of retirement from 67 to 65 that we had inherited from the Conservative government, the previous Conservative government. We also increased the GIS top-up, and now we're offering options for Canadians to be able to choose their pensions and decide what their fate will be for their retirement. That is what we're offering.
And
here's the thing. The thing is, what happens is when the government tries to regulate marijuana, it will definitely increase the price of marijuana itself. My question is always, what's going to stop the person from buying, you know, for example, a $5 joint at, you know, a government regulated store, or going just around the corner and getting it for $2? If, you know, I truly don't believe in what the Liberal government is saying, that they're going to take this away from the criminals, and that they're going to, you know, I think they're overvaluing how much taxes they think they're gonna get off the sale of marijuana. Thank you.
Well, I favor the legalization of marijuana. I'm a former federal prosecutor, and I've seen firsthand the extent to which the prohibition against marijuana disproportionately affects young people and minorities. It also gives the police a very broad basis to conduct searches of people in excess, I think, of what the law should permit. I agree with the approach of regulating. I think it's very disappointing that the government has taken this long to do it, because the NDP had advocated for decriminalization in the short term until such time that an appropriate regime could be put in place. And we've seen the downside of the approach the government has taken with the proliferation of marijuana dispensaries. For any of you that may think they constitute a gray area legally, they do not. They're illegal drug trafficking operations, but they're being popped up throughout our city. And I think it's causing a lot of confusion for people. Meanwhile, we've got, you know, 18-year-old kids that are still getting picked up for half a gram of pot, and they find themselves potentially with a criminal record that will prohibit them from traveling to the United States, possibly for the rest of their life, that will interfere with their job prospects. And I just strongly feel that a public health approach is the appropriate approach to take. And so I do agree in principle with the approach the Liberals are taking. I think it's taking far too long. I think their rhetoric from the last campaign, which was around, you know, essentially the fact that marijuana is not that harmful and should be available for recreational use, and is now very focused on the harms and the dangers to our children. The danger to our children from our record is just as
Thank
serious.
You.
I agree that we need to have a clear and responsible regulation and restricted access of marijuana, protecting our young people, protecting other vulnerable people in our society. I also agree that we need to be working collaboratively with public health and public education to make sure that people are aware of the risks associated with, depending on your age and health status, the risks associated with any kind of extended use of this, like any other substance. Our current opioid crisis across the country, our discussions about safe injection sites, all of these point to the need for involving public health and public education from the ground up. It's not just a law and order issue. Thank you.
Fact, the bookies have spoken. U.S. insurance companies say high drivers have less accidents. So it's time to have our designated high driver law to keep the drugs and the streets off the roads. Protect the kids, they say. Protect the kids. Marijuana's never had a death. And marijuana regrows new brain cells, which is why I'm so sharp and you're so dull. So anyway, you're going to need cannabis soil very soon because of the cancers you're going to get from sucking up Fukushima radiation for the last 5 years. And the supply is not ready for you. So when you need it, you're not going to get it, you're going to regret not having fought for legalization harder, and this is life and death. This stuff can kill cancer, the oil, and you can't get any. And fresh juice, and you can't get any, and you probably never will, because they want to restrict it, because they want to protect the kids from extra brain cells. So, I don't. They want to give their kids Ritalin and Prozac, I want to give them a marijuana muffin. Talk about safety.
Hypocrisy on the Liberal government. veterans. There's been a lot of discussion recently about the role that prescription marijuana has played for veterans who are suffering from a large number of disorders related to their service. And now it's been decided that bureaucrats at Health Canada are going to determine what the appropriate dose is because there's some kind of a sense of overprescription. These are medical prescriptions written by physicians, and I don't think it's appropriate for bureaucrats to be interfering in the same way they are when it comes to funding for health for our First Nations children, unfortunately.
Thanks, everyone. That concludes the question portion. We'll now give each... We'll give her another round of applause. We'll now proceed with concluding statements. Each candidate will have 1 minute to provide a concluding statement. And we will begin this with Ms. Fortune. Yes.
Merci beaucoup d'être venu ce soir. Thank you for coming out this evening. Thank you to the organizers, especially for having us and to putting up with us tonight. I know on election night 2015, no one expected us to be back debating so soon. And I want to recognize Mabel Bélanger, my mentor, and my friend who was in this seat for 21 years. Ottawa Vanier is my home and where I have chosen to raise my young family. Ottawa Vanier, l'endroit où j'ai travaillé pendant les 20 dernières années pour dialoguer avec mes voisins et surtout pour appuyer nos entreprises, nos institutions communautaires et nos organisations bénévoles. But most importantly, by being here, I have heard and intrinsically understand the challenges that we have in this riding, and I understand they are as dynamic, diverse, as the opportunities that our communities offer. I would be honored to have your support on April 3rd,
Thank you.
Hopefully hear from you after.
What was discussed in this debate tonight will be an opportunity for you to decide how you're going to vote on next Monday. And I just want to remind you that the budget came out last week, and we're running a $28.5 billion deficit, and Justin Trudeau has no plan to return us to balance. And to add to this, they are now nickel and diming Canadians. They're raising taxes on beer and wine, Uber, I'm an Uber user myself, and public transit. A lot of you take the public transit, and now you won't be able to claim your monthly bus passes. The Conservatives, on the other hand, we will fight for Canadian taxpayers. So on April 3rd, please take the opportunity to send the Liberal government a message that your vote will no longer be taken for granted. And I hope you vote for me so I can start working to keep the Liberals accountable. And I know at the last debate, Ms. Fortune said that, the NDP and the Conservatives have no leader,
you.
But at least you don't have a leader.
Thank you.
Huge. They're the best pressures. If we don't strengthen the opposition, our government will continue to take voters for granted and the needs of this riding will continue to be ignored. We need an MP who will work locally with the community and who has the ability to defend our interests on a national level. I grew up in a family that has a strong history of public service. It's part of who I am. My time as a public prosecutor has prepared me well to get to the heart of a problem, build a consensus, and broker real solutions. The Liberals may have broken their promise to make every vote count, but next Monday, you can make your vote count if you vote for me. I promise I won't let you down. Votez pour moi, je promets ne pas vous laisser tomber. Bunswami. Thank you.
We need clean water, clean air, and healthy soil for the present and the future. We have to get real about that. We have to get real and understand that we can't build an economy on something that's destructive of those things. I believe the Green Party's robust platform and vision of a caring, compassionate, fiscally responsible, peacemaking, and just society is the vision that should carry us into the future. That's why I got involved in this project here. I have a perfectly good job as a high school teacher and only stepped up to do my part because I feel very strongly that the Green Party's vision is worth a look. Give us a chance. Nobody can deny that the work Elizabeth May does as one MP in the House is exponentially valuable in holding the governments to account and in providing innovative, creative, collaborative, consensual ways of approaching our shared concerns and challenges as Canadians. Thank you.
Debate for the evening.